So this is how we entered the Cold War. The Cold War was about East-West struggle. But that struggle in the post-war period would be waged within the framework of an imperfect but still existing world order. And what's more, the logic of that competition between East and West would be contributing to the rise and to the development of a world order. The most interesting and I think the most persuasive evidence of that logic is in the nuclear arms race. Okay, they build nuclear weapons. Why do they build them? Well, they're bigger and bigger, better weapons. They give you muscle to put pressure on the other guy and, if need be, to fight and win war. And then, when this nuclear arms race moves into its second decade, at the end of its second decade, both sides discover that they cannot fight and win nuclear war. They discover that they have to talk to each other about minimizing the risks of a nuclear, because they recognize that they're in conflict, they're in competition, and they have all those nukes. And there are people on both sides who say, well, if we have those nukes, we should use them. In the late 1950s, there were two particularly interesting individuals who thought that the big East-West struggle between capitalism and communism can and should be resolved with nuclear weapons. On the American side, there was General Curtis LeMay, old Iron Pants LeMay, as they called him, who was the chair of the Strategic Air Command. He couldn't understand what the pussyfooting politicians were waiting for. You know, while the Americans had a huge preponderance in nuclear weapons over the Soviet Union, sure enough. On the other side of the spectrum, there was Mao Zedong, who was putting tremendous pressure on Nikita Khrushchev, the Soviet leader, not to be afraid of nuclear war and just, you know, go full swing. You know, I mean, we'll destroy the source of all evil, the American Empire. And that would be the end of course, hundreds of millions of people would die, but then the rest of them would live happily ever after. I mean, of course, they had no idea. The most stunning thing about those debates is that they had no idea of the ecological consequences of nuclear war. They were not factoring it in. When President Kennedy became president, he requested detailed plans for waging nuclear war. The generals were not particularly happy with the request because President Eisenhower, never actually looked into the detail. So for the first time, the commander-in-chief was able to see the detailed plan, standard integrated operational plan, COP. When he looked at it, he was aghast, and he asked, I think it was LeMay, because he was in charge of the nukes, he asked him how many people were likely to die after this massive unleashing of nuclear fighting power on the Soviet Union and its allies. He said, well, between 500 and 600 million people, give or take a few hundred. Not just in Russia and China, but also in countries around Russia and China. And Kennedy was shocked by it, because he plainly thought that there was nothing that could justify that kind of mega murder. He was very competitive. He was fully intent on winning the Cold War, winning it ideologically, winning it for democracy, for the West, against totalitarianism and communism, being able to appeal to the energies of the rising global South, which was fighting to free itself from colonialism. But he was not ready to see this mega murder as the price of the conflict. And neither were they on the Soviet side. Mao Zedong never got what he wanted from Khrushchev. And in 1963, following the Cuban Missile Crisis, we had the first step in the creation of what we now call the architecture of nuclear arms control. In 63, the three countries, the three nuclear powers at the time, Soviet Union, United States, and Great Britain, signed an agreement which banned the testing of nuclear weapons anywhere except underground. And that was an important step, because at the time they were testing like crazy and they were gumming up the atmosphere, and it became an important public issue. So for me, it's an interesting demonstration of how the logic of confrontation inexorably leads to the need to negotiate and create instruments for cooperation. In fact, what's happened, if you examine the history of US-Russian relations, there has to be a bad crisis for the countries to be jolted into trying to work out another arrangement, another cooperative arrangement. First, they have to go to you know, heightened tensions and the dangerous jockeying for position. And then they discover that, hey, actually, you know, there are better ways. And then they reel back and they negotiate and they come to an agreement. This is how we kept the peace during the Cold War. So the Cold War is actually, it has many interesting aspects. On the one hand, there was the US-Soviet rivalry. There were the two superpowers who were competing for world power and influence. There were two grand alliances facing each other off, NATO and Warsaw Pact. Millions of troops on both sides, preparing for a war which they knew would be the end of the world. I mean, the military on both sides knew only too well that once they were to engage in a serious fighting, like World War II level fighting, even without nuclear weapons, Europe would be obliterated, would have become unlivable. So they were a little philosophical about their jobs was to stand there and be ready for war. By the way, both sides had strategies which were predicated not on them striking first, but the other side striking first. But we now know from the documents that neither side had plans for striking first. That's interesting. Imagine, you know, a very tense relationship, very armed relationship, where both sides know that they're not going to strike first. And so they build up their arsenals and they say, yeah, okay, I'll hit you if you strike first. I'll hit you if you strike first. But I'm not going to be so at some point sanity had to be introduced into this kind of game, and it was introduced. In the 1980s we saw the climbing down from this confrontation, drastic reductions in both nuclear and conventional forces and so on. So, but still, think of those confrontations, the arms race, the threat of nuclear war, local wars, Korea, Vietnam, Afghanistan, and so on and so forth. I remember observing the goings-on in Vietnam. I was a student at the time, and frankly, I was convinced that the Vietnamese didn't have a chance because they were confronted by the full power of the United States military. And how come? How could the United States have possibly lost that war? And yet it lost it because that war was actually a sideshow to a much bigger project of developing an international order. And it was a big blunder when the United States chose not to recognize the new government in Vietnam, even though it was led by communist Ho Chi Minh and his party in 1945, which was desperate to be recognized by the United States. They didn't want to be a Soviet or Chinese puppet, but their fate was to be suppressed by the French because the interests of European rebuilding Europe and warding off the communist threat in Europe dictated that Washington does not support the loss of the French colonial empire. So the French were allowed to come back to Vietnam and start suppressing the nationalists, the communists who were the nationalists, and so on and so forth. So when that logic was critically addressed in the United States domestic dialogue in the 1960s and 1970s, it proved to be quite possible to not only withdraw from Vietnam, but then heal the wounds and then prepare better for the struggle for a better world order. Or China, which was bad communist China for a long period of time, until Richard Nixon discovered that if he sheds ideology and treats the situation in Eurasia from the point of view of geopolitics, then forming a triangular relationship between the United States, China, and Russia might actually be a better deal for the United States. If you can maneuver around the growing split between China and Russia, then you could be actually helping yourself quite a bit. And by the way, that triangle is still there. And its geometry keeps changing, as everything in this world, but it's very interesting. You know, Nixon used the China card to make the Soviet Union more pliable in negotiations, and that worked. And then when the Soviet Union was dissolved in 1991, the Chinese leadership began to maneuver in various ways vis-a-vis the United States, and one of the Chinese leaders famously said in the late 90s, you use the China card against the Russians, we'll now be using the Russian card against you. And the Russians are using the China card against Americans. Well, just watch what's going on. But it's interesting how that triangle, it's as if there is something in the nature of things for the sides of the triangle be equal. Whenever one of the sides begins to shrink, it might be good for the guys who are on the shrinking, on the ends of the shrinking part, but the guy who is out there at great distance from both sides, that's not a nice position to be in. But anyway, also think of the period of the Cold War as a period of unprecedented and sustained economic growth, resulting in drastic improvement of living conditions, at least in the developed world. And by the way, both on the eastern and western side of the great ideological divide, because both in state socialist countries and in the democratic capitalist countries, we saw drastic improvements and the creation of the welfare state and so on and so forth. The colonial empires were dissolved. They came crashing down, liberating the majority of humanity from the yoke under which they lived before. That was great progress, not to mention scientific and technological revolution and globalization, which has bound the destinies of nations together more tightly than ever before, for better or for worse. So let's think of the United States and the Soviet Union in the Cold War as being competitive stewards of that world order. We should be thankful to them for keeping their rivalry in check, for moving to create a relatively safe mechanism of arms control, and for continuing to negotiate. Because both sides, whatever differences between them might have been, they had fundamental shared interests in survival, peace, security, and so on and so forth. They disagreed and they fought on a lot of issues, but the fundamentals were never touched. As a result, we have survived and we have moved on. And in fact, what is more symbolic of the strange character of the Cold War, if not the remarkable success of President Reagan and General Secretary Mikhail Gorbachev in the second half of the 1980s in negotiating an end to a Cold War? Nobody expected that. Nobody thought it was possible. In 1983, President Reagan, speaking to an evangelicals conference, famously called Russia the focus of all evil in the modern world. And then he kind of expanded on that, showing that these are people, they're just terrible. You can't do any business with them because they will deceive, they will lie, they'll do anything. Terrible people. 5 years later, the same president is basking in the May sun in the middle of the Kremlin, and Gorbachev is introducing kids, say, meet Grandfather Reagan, and then and CBS News, Dan Rather, sticks a microphone into the president's face. Mr. President, you're in the middle of the evil empire. And then he smiles, he's sunny, smiles, oh, that's already gone, that's a past era. How could you so quickly navigate from the evil empire to a new age where we're all friends and doing business together and so on and so forth? Well, because the confrontation was always only part of the picture. And as a result of a number of historical forces and brilliant leadership coming mostly from Russia, let's admit it, Gorbachev played a more important role in bringing the Cold War to a conclusion, because it was not just about U.S.-Russian relations. Gorbachev recognized and acted upon that recognition, the profound crisis of state socialism. What looked like a promising experiment for the future of mankind by the end of the 20th century turned into a demonstration of some fundamental crisis of the system. So he moved to address that crisis on terms which were not only understandable but acceptable to the West. You need some form of market economy, right? You can't rely on state ownership and state planning. You need some form of democracy, because unless the media is free and people are free to choose their governments and so on and so forth, it's not, your political system is not going to be effective. Okay, and you need to accept the fact that the world is united and address the issues in cooperation with others to make that world safe, in particular safe from the danger of nuclear war. So we saw the end of the Cold War, but how do we conceptualize the end of the Cold War now? I'd like to quote here from somebody I actually happen to know personally, because he was ambassador, United States, Reagan's ambassador to Moscow, and I remember a number of conversations few of them were friendly, I must say, because we rarely agreed on anything. I didn't particularly like that individual, but he became a key policymaker under Reagan, and especially because I didn't particularly like him, I take delight in quoting from his recent article in the Washington Post. A failure to appreciate how the Cold War ended has had a profound impact on Russian and Western attitudes and helps explain what we are seeing now. The common assumption that the West forced the collapse of the Soviet Union and thus won the Cold War is wrong. Now let me repeat. The common assumption that the West forced the collapse of the Soviet Union and thus won the Cold War is wrong. Sounds strange? The fact is that the Cold War ended by negotiation to the advantage of both sides. And that's how it ended. Because it ended a few years before the dissolution of the Soviet Union. Now, of course, those events were connected. But it's important to remember that both sides were seen as winners. They were no losers at the negotiating table that proclaimed proudly and happily to the world that the Cold War was over. And the fact that you could not imagine a more ideologically polarized pair of statesmen than Ronald Reagan, who made his whole career on militant and hardline anti-communism, and Gorbachev, who was at the time the most influential member of the Communist Party of anywhere in the world. So the ideological differences were not that important. What was important was that they acted upon their common interest and the common interests of mankind. But the important thing was that the Soviet Union, which was changing in ways which were acceptable and understandable and supportable by the West, was something that the Russians did not to please the West, but because they thought democratization, the market economy, demilitarization was in the interests of the Russian people, of the Soviet people. That was the only way out from the systemic crisis of the Soviet system. So that is an important thing. It wasn't because, you know, the Russians were kind of pinned into the corner and then they said, okay, we will have competitive elections now because Reagan is threatening us nuclear war. Come on, I grew up dreaming of competitive elections since the time I was 16 because it was always ridiculous to go to the ballot box, you know, on another Soviet election where there would be just one candidate for the job. You know, when we had our first competitive election, parliamentary, in 1989, I took my son to the ballot box, to the ballot place, right? And he was 10 years old. And he was too bored to go, but I persuaded him. So together we get into the booth, and there's a list of candidates for the first time in my life. Well, and I tell him, Vasya, this is a special moment. You know, we now have to choose, let's choose this guy. And the guy's name was Boris Yeltsin, by the way, was running. I said, because he is the best of them all. And said, okay. Said, okay, I don't mind. Okay, we then marked that name, then dropped the ballot into the box, and then we walk out, and I'm terribly excited. I say, Vasya, you've just taken part in something historic. He said, Dad, what's so historic about that? I said, well, you voted in an election when there's a choice between candidates. He said, Dad, how can there be an election without a choice? And I felt like my whole life had been wasted. And he just takes it for granted. I mean, Sebastian, do you understand how many things had to change before we came to this point?